is a very special day for us as a nation, as a people, both corporately and individually. I don't like to look at things as simply that we are survivors, but I think every life event can enable us to get better and to become a better nation, or to, in simplistic words, to become bitter, to lose grounding or to gain grounding. And today I believe I have a word from the Lord, and that word from the Lord is not only going to be prophetic, but it's also on how do you heal after losses and tragedy and devastating things that you go through in life. 9/11 forever changed the landscape, not just of America, and so many of us individually. 20% of Americans were impacted by someone directly that they loved or was in their family or friend, with over 2,819 lives that were lost on that day. We also have 3,051 children who are survivors of victims, from the firemen to the policemen to workers who woke up and thought it was going to be an ordinary day. We remember them and we honor the legacy of their life. But not only that, we have to be reflective and inspective. We need to look and say, as a nation and as a people, I'm going to preach very authentic today because that's really all I know how to do. But to look and say, who are we and where are we living, and how can we become who God called us to be? Because I remind you that when our founders founded this nation, they landed on Plymouth Rock and they took hundreds of crosses and they lined a way and they dedicated this nation, and they asked God for it to be a beacon, to be a light to the world, that we would send missionaries around the world till everyone had heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. I believe that America was founded to preach the gospel, to be a nation, one nation under God. And I love our country. There's something that just messes me all up when we start singing the national anthem. And many of you know that after my father's death when I was 5, my mother remarried 9, a two-star admiral. So I grew up military and moved 14 different times, and kind of runs all through me. And God knew how to train me for ministry by putting protocol and order in me in military. And boy, you better say yes, sir. And I'm just grateful for my background and the history. And today, I want to give you the word of the Lord. Look at somebody and say, God has a better tomorrow for us if we allow him to. So I want to take it from both corporately, for our nation, to our church, to our city, and individually to our personal life. Because we are only good as a unit as we are good as a people. The family is as strong as the individual. The church is as strong as the family. The nation is as strong as the church. So as we become better within ourselves, then we build a better people and a better community and a better nation. Amen? Look at somebody, say, God has an assignment for you. God has an assignment. If I had to give today a title, I would subtitle it probably Learning to Live Again. And when Simone was dancing, that's one of my favorite songs. I know it should be a gospel song, but that's one of my favorite songs. I think Martina McBride just got anointed when she said, I hope you dance again. And I don't know everyone's personal story, but I do understand a little bit about life. And no matter what you've gone through, don't ever quit. Don't ever give up. Beside the love of God, the one characteristic I would say that you have to have is perseverance. That is the ability to go through anything that life will hand you and stand firm. My spiritual father, Bishop Jakes, taught me in the most dark days of my life. He said, keep standing. He said, don't give up on God. Don't give up on life. Don't give up on what you see right now. But if you keep standing, he said, Paul, it's like the earth that rotates around the sun. Everything will rotate. Weeping endures for the night, but joy cometh in the morning. He said, it's a season and seasons do change. And if you keep standing, not only will you love again and laugh again and live again, but the God that you serve is a faithful God. That the glory of the latter house is greater than the glory of the former house. That he's a God of increase. And he takes you, maybe not God's sent, but God used through things. And if you will allow those things, they'll not only develop you and cultivate you, but they'll make you stronger and wiser, more selfless, more appreciative of life. In fact, when you've lost something, you have a real appreciation for everything that you have left in your life. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, God is a good God. And so learning to live again, I'm going to teach you that our guide to hope and help. Or if I were to title it, it would be the battle before the breakthrough. Go with me to 1 Samuel chapter 30 as we examine the life of David. Now we have the benefit of hindsight. So we know that David is going to win. We know that he's going to succeed in doing all that God's assigned for him. The book of Acts will tell us that David will do all the will of the Lord and that he will leave something that outlives his life, that he will fulfill legacy and lineage, and he will build something of eternal value. But at this point in his life, David, he's not sure. He's at the most critical time. It looks debilitating and devastating. And I'm so glad that God doesn't just skip over those times. I was going to preach on the God of the valleys, because when Israel was up against the Assyrian army, they said, "You're not going to make it. We're going to defeat you," because they only win. Israel only defeats up on the mountaintop. He's the God of the high place. He's the God of the mountaintop. Little did they know that if they got him down in the plain in the valley, he was also the God of the valley. He's also the God of difficulties. "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff comfort me." Thank God he's not only the God of the good times and the God of the mountaintop, but he's also the God of difficult days, which tells me that he can take me through anything. That with God, we can go through anything. Our God is a good and a faithful God. So stand with me for the reading of God's word. Stand with me for the reading of God's word. And Marvin and Mo, I see you back there, and I want to see little Marvin. We'll bring him up before the end of service. Little man's here today. Come on up here. Come on up. Bring him up. Let's just show him off. Y'all don't mind seeing Marvin and Monique did a good job. I know he's got to look just like his mama, because I've seen pictures. He's real good looking. Marvin Winans Jr., which y'all already know. You know the Winans family, Gospel Legacy, but he's been with us for years and years, and his beautiful, beautiful wife, Monique, and they just had their firstborn. And I remember laying hands. They kept trying and couldn't, and I laid hands and prophesied, and our God is a... Oh, so handsome. I know, mama. Oh, Father, bless him in Jesus' name. I thank you for this mighty man of God. I thank you for the fulfillment of every prophetic word over him in Jesus' name. Amen. Isn't this awesome? Come on, do you remember praying? Laying hands on Mo, laid hands on Mo, laid hands on Jillian, laid hands on Evelyn. All of them are pregnant. We're going to build this church one way or the other. Put your hands together and tell them how much you love them. I love to see God's faithfulness. See, when a doctor tells you no, King Jesus says yes. The battle before the breakthrough. 1 Samuel chapter 30. Let's read verse 1 down to about verse 10, and we'll pick up in verse 18. Let me hear you. "And it came to pass, when David and his men were come to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag and smitten Ziklag and burned it with fire and had taken the women captives that were therein. They slew not any, either great or small, but carried them away and went on their way." Now that's a miracle right there, that they didn't kill them. They took them. Verse 3. "So David and his men came to the city, and behold, it was burned with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters were taken captives. Then David and the people that were with them lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep." I love his leadership, because David is not standing to the side detached, but he's hurting and he's weeping. And together, you know, they're going through this thing, this journey called life. Verse 5. "And David's two wives were taken captives, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess and Abigail, the wife of Nabal the Carmelite. And David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his son and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God." Let's say verse 6 again. I want you to get it, because here the people, because they're grieved, they're going to turn on the leader now, because they're hurting, because hurt people hurt people. And when we're hurting, we project that hurt out, and we're angry at people, and we're angry at the government and the pastor and our ex-spouse and our current beau, whoever it is. And you just get angry. You're mad. And the people wanted to kill David. But watch what David does. Let me hear you. "And David was greatly distressed, For the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself, and the Lord is God. Look at somebody, say, you have to learn how to encourage yourself. Turn to somebody you haven't talked to. Call their name out. Call their name out. Say, Arnell, you better learn. Encourage yourself. Look at one more person you haven't talked to and just call them out. Call them out. Say, Michael, encourage yourself. In verse 7, and David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, I pray thee, bring me hither the ephod. And Abiathar brought hither the ephod to David. And David inquired at the Lord, saying, shall I pursue after this troop? God, he's saying, what shall I do? Shall I overtake them? And God answered him, pursue. Now here's the prophetic word. For thou shalt surely overtake them, and without fail. Without what, guys? Without fail. He's going to do what? Recover all. Everything you lost, I'm going to prophesy to you today. Whatever the enemy came to destroy you with, because I'm going to expose what that spirit was that was unleashed. I decree and I declare there is full restoration. You will recover all. All your peace, all your joy, all your giftings, all your family, all your finances. You will, without fail, I prophesy to you without walls. I prophesy to you chosen, appointed, and anointed. You will recover all. Look at somebody, say, I'm getting it back. I'm getting my stuff back. And your stuff is your peace, your purpose, come on, your joy, your abundant life, your family, everything that God promised you. So David went, he and 600 men that were with him came to the brook Besor, where those that were left behind stayed. And David pursued 400 men. 200 were behind because they were so faint they could not go over the brook. It tells the rest of the story. Go with me to verse 18. And David did what? Recovered. How much, guys? Verse 18. And David, all that the Amalekites had carried away. And David rescued his two wives. And there was nothing lacking to them, neither small nor great, neither sons nor daughters, neither spoil nor anything that they had taken to them. David recovered all. And David took all the flocks and the herds which they drave before those other cattle and said, this is David's spoil. Now the God that I serve is the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. Now, Ziklag before Zion is one of the most devastating. I mean, they have destroyed everything. They destroyed the military base, the community, everything that David would need to go into his future. But God, after David had encouraged himself, said, pursue, go get it. I'm with you. You will recover all. I believe I have a word. I know I'm a realist. I'm not a doom and gloom preacher. I'm not a false illusion. This is the real deal, but this is what God says. We know in the last 10 years that as a people, we have lived some of the most difficult days as a nation. We've gone through recession. We've gone through confusion. I mean, even in the last few weeks, we've had hurricanes up in New York, earthquakes in Washington, D.C. We live in times like we've never lived before. We have wildfires burning everything down in Texas. We have people that still are unemployed. We have governments that can't make decisions. Come on, we are living. But God has called us to work a night shift. And God was not confused to release you for such a time as this. There is a purpose and a plan. And God tells us the end from the beginning, which I'm going to expose to you today. That the plan of God is the glory of the latter house will be greater than the glory of the former house. There is a great outpouring of God's Spirit. We're not going to go out of this thing weak and defeated. And even though we've got some battles, we do also have breakthrough. And breakthrough is not simply, I got through to survive. Breakthrough is, I'm advancing in an offensive position to be all that God said I could be, to have all that God said I can have, and to do what God said I can do. I believe that God's not through with a America. I believe that God's not through with without walls. I believe God's not through with your life. I'm going to preach from a different perspective. I don't believe that God's after America. I believe God is for America because I understand the patterns of God. Until there's not one righteous left, then he's not through. Because he would not destroy Sodom and Gomorrah until there was not one righteous left. As long as I'm alive, as long as Pastor Michael's alive, as long as you are alive, I believe that God is for us, and I believe that it's time that we take our position. Now, we've made a mess of things ourselves, but we can't be blaming God for some of the stuff we've done. It's time that we rise to the occasion and be who God has called us to be.